Justine Greening. Photograph Justin Tallis, AFP, Getty Images. The most widely tipped loser in today's reshuffle, Greening became Education Secretary after Theresa May took over as Prime Minister in 2016, replacing another Remain-minded Tory, Nicky Morgan. Morgan has since become one of the government's most effective backbench critics, and Greening departed after refusing to be moved to the Department for Work and Pensions. The talk is that Greening had to go because of her supposed cozying up to teaching unions and her lack of enthusiasm over the policy of creating new grammar schools. Some critics believed Greening risked capture by the blob, the mass of education experts and unions so named by Michael Gove when he was in the role. A 2005 entrant to Parliament, Greening was briefly the Transport Secretary and then, for 4 years, the International Development Secretary before overseeing education. She had risen rapidly under David Cameron and was perhaps politically more suited to his era, not least with her strongly pro-Remain beliefs. The first education secretary whose entire secondary education was at a comprehensive, Greening took a relatively conciliatory attitude towards teaching unions in her time in the job, even during a lengthy battle over the level of funding for schools. The issue of new grammar schools, introduced into the 2017 manifesto to placate more traditionalist Tory MPs, might have caused Greening difficulties, as she clearly struggled to raise enthusiasm for a policy which, as the evidence shows, does very little to promote social mobility. However, the loss of the party's majority in the election led to the grammar's policy being mothballed on the assumption it would struggle to get through the Commons. Peter Wackerup, Jeremy Hunt, Secretary of State for Health and Social Care. Jeremy Hunt. Photograph, Daniel Leal Olivas, AFP, Getty Images. After handling the politically perilous NHS brief for an impressive 5 years and 4 months, Jeremy Hunt may regard his expanded role as the Secretary of State for Health and Social Care as a poison chalice as much as a promotion. He is now responsible for two of the biggest challenges facing the government, both of which provoke constant political heat and regular, high-profile pleas for extra billions of Treasury spending. May's decision to enlarge Hunt's portfolio may reflect a belief on her part that he can bring what admirers see as his calm, reassuring approach to the NHS's many problems to the equally complicated issues in social care. English Council's adult social care budgets have been cut by £6 billion since 2010. That means fewer people have been getting help just when an aging population has increased the need to provide practical help for older people with day-to-day tasks as well as to find them places in care homes. Delayed transfers of care, the inability to discharge medically fit patients from hospitals due to the widespread difficulty of arranging a package of social care support to keep them safe, is a key reason many hospitals are dangerously all year round, not just this winter. But this major policy change makes sense for a government that for years has seen integration of health and social care as the best way of keeping the NHS from crumbling, though progress towards that goal has been piecemeal, not dramatic. Dennis Campbell up, David Lidington, Cabinet Office Minister and Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster. David Lidington. Photographed, Simon Dawson, Reuters. David Lidington was Justice Secretary for 6 months before being called on by Theresa May to steady the ship in the Cabinet Office. On paper, it looks like a sideways cabinet move, as Lidington gains the courtesy title of Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster but loses a meaty policy portfolio. However, he has greater importance than the title suggests because Lidington is taking over responsibilities from May's former de facto deputy, Damian Green, who was sacked for lying about the presence of O-graphic images on his House of Commons computer. Lidington is not getting Green's title of First Secretary of State, but the real importance of the Cabinet Office role is taking over chairmanship of at least some of the important Cabinet committees, including the big Brexit ones. That means he will be in charge of navigating Cabinet divisions on some big Brexit policies over the coming months. Lidington was a passionate supporter of staying in the EU, as a former Europe minister for years under Cameron. But he is also regarded as clever and fair by his colleagues, with a good eye for detail and practicalities. It is not clear yet whether he will deputize for May at Prime Minister's questions. He has done so in the past as leader of the Commons, but he was outshone when he made his first outing against Labour's Emily Thornberry. Rowena Mason up, Karen Bradley, Northern Ireland Secretary. Karen Bradley. Photograph, Facundo Arrizabalaga, EPA. In appointing Karen Bradley to the politically sensitive job, Theresa May hopes to have put Northern Ireland in a safe pair of hands, replacing one trusted former Home Office colleague with another. Not to be underestimated, said some who know the 47-year-old, Bradley is said to be sharp, firm and unfazed by big battles, having referred Rupert Murdoch's takeover bid for Sky TV to the competition authorities. Others said she merely covered her back on the Sky deal. Northern Ireland is a difficult brief to take on at such a sensitive time and will require political skill, acumen, patience and determination. The Irish border remains contentious in Brexit talks, and a tough decision on ruling Northern Ireland directly from Westminster is looming large if the impasse in talks is not broken. Bradley will not have the luxury of time to read in the brief and will be required to hit the ground running with meetings with all the parties in the previous Northern Ireland Assembly. Lisa O'Carroll up, Brandon Lewis, party chairman and minister without portfolio, Brandon Lewis. Photograph, Stefan Russo, PA. Brandon Lewis' rise to party chairman is an example of Theresa May rewarding loyalty. The 46-year-old was instrumental in her leadership campaign, rallying support from Conservative MPs behind the scenes. Since then, he has served in her old patch at the Home Office, gaining a promotion to Immigration Minister attending Cabinet after last year's election. Despite having supported the Remain campaign at the EU referendum, Lewis has embraced the drive to create a new immigration system and spearheaded the proposed return to Navy Blue passports after Brexit. He was well regarded by the party under Cameron and tipped for promotion before the 2015 election, although the opposition points to his responsibility for the troubled policy areas of housing and fire safety during the coalition years. Colleagues are likely to appreciate Lewis' campaigning experience, as he won a marginal seat in the coastal area of Great Yarmouth from Labour in 2010. In the next two elections, he built up his majority and saw off a threat from UKIP. However, there may be skepticism about whether he is the right man to overhaul the party's social media operation. His own efforts have been mocked, including a video about why Great Yarmouth is great that featured him making thumbs-up signs in front of local landmarks. Rowena Mason in. James Cleverly, Deputy Party Chair. James Cleverly. Photograph, Daniel Leal Olivas, AFP, Getty Images. James Cleverly has made no secret of his ambitions to go far in the Conservative Party, openly saying he would love to be Prime Minister one day. If I was wearing an England rugby shirt and someone tapped me on the shoulder and said, "Would you like to captain the team?" of course you would bite their hand off. So, of course, in the same context, if you're passionate about politics and you want to make a difference and someone said, "Do you want to be Prime Minister?" I think most of us would go, "Oh God, I'd love to do that," he said in an interview last year. The MP for Braintree was elected only in 2015 but has made a name for himself over the past 2 years as a fierce defender of the party with a vibrant social media account. A former London Assembly leader for the Conservatives, he was a Brexit supporter at the referendum, who subsequently backed Boris Johnson's abortive leadership bid in 2016. However, he swiftly became an effective cheerleader for May's government, with frequent media appearances and a prolific presence on Twitter. His reputation for being a straight talker was cemented in 2015, when he admitted in a radio interview to having looked at pornography and dabbled in illegal drugs, and then took part in a game of snog, Marie, avoid, choosing to avoid the journalist Isabel Oakeshott, marry Yvette Cooper and snog Theresa May. Rowena Mason up, Matt Hancock, Culture Secretary Matt Hancock. Photograph, Daniel Leal Olivas, AFP, Getty Images. The Graham fan will be a popular appointment as Culture Secretary for many in the media industry. In his position as digital minister, Hancock has been a cheerleader for Britain's fledgling technology industry but has also spoken out about fake news and the dangers of social media. His political career appeared to suffer a setback when May replaced Cameron as prime minister. May demoted him from the cabinet, moving him from cabinet office minister to the digital brief. But, with Bradley's move to the Northern Ireland brief, Hancock has been rewarded with a promotion for knuckling down and getting on with his job. One of his first decisions will be about whether to allow 21st Century Fox to buy Sky when the Competition and Markets Authority publishes its recommendations. Graham Ruddick out, Patrick McLaughlin. Patrick McLaughlin. Photograph, Daniel Leal Olivas, AFP, Getty Images. The Conservative Party chairman, whose cabinet seat comes via an official government role as Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster, McLaughlin had been seen as almost certain to go after the disastrous general election campaign, which was followed by a misfiring party conference. McLaughlin was blamed, allies say unfairly, for overseeing security lapses such as a prankster gaining access to the conference hall in Manchester and handing Theresa May a fake P45 as she made her leader's speech. He will nonetheless be one of the less noted cabinet departures, managing to keep a low public profile despite having been in Parliament for more than 30 years, and on the front bench for almost as long. McLaughlin's first junior ministerial post was given to him by Margaret Thatcher in 1989. However, the 60-year-old is by no means a traditional Conservative grandee. After attending a state school in Staffordshire and the local agricultural college, McLaughlin worked as a farm laborer and miner, also becoming a local councillor and then, aged just 28, succeeding Matthew Paris as MP for West Derbyshire, now known as Derbyshire Dales, when Paris quit politics for journalism, prompting a by-election. A supporter of Remain in the Brexit referendum, McLaughlin spent many years in the Whip's office, finally gaining a cabinet job in 2012 at Transport, where he battled controversies over rail franchises and HS2, Peter Wacker out, James Brokenshire, James Brokenshire. Photographed Liam McBurney, PA. The timing of James Brokenshire's departure from his post as Northern Ireland Secretary couldn't be worse, coming just 2 days before the first anniversary of the collapse of power-sharing at Stormont. His resignation on health grounds was an early blow to Theresa May, but it is also a setback for Northern Ireland, which is at yet another critical stage in its history. Northern Ireland has in the past been seen as either a wilderness or a poison chalice for incomers to the office, but it is now one of the most critical posts in the cabinet, with the Irish border one of the trickiest issues in the second phase of Brexit talks. Brokenshire, who celebrated his 50th birthday on Sunday, was considered a stabilising force, Kerry walking the thin political tightrope after his predecessor Theresa Villiers, whose open support for Brexit divided the Remain voting region. An MP since 2005, he was a loyal supporter of Theresa May, with whom he worked at the Home Office, and he was able to play a key role in keeping the Brexit talks intact, after an 11th-hour intervention by the DUP threatened a scuppery deal last month. He also had a good working relationship with Ireland's Foreign Minister, Simon Coveney, and his predecessor, Charlie Flanagan. Critics say the passing of one Stormont deadline after another showed Brokenshire's lack of influence in talks, but the death of Martin McGuinness undoubtedly left a hole in leadership on the nationalist side, with Sinn Féin struggling to get its voice heard in Westminster at a time when the DUP's confidence and supply agreement had put them in the corridors of power. After discovering a lesion on his right lung that requires surgery, Brokenshire said he would not be fit enough to offer the energy that Northern Ireland requires. His successor faces huge challenges against the clock. Lisa O'Carroll up, David Gowk, Justice Secretary David Gowk. Photographed Paul Davey, Barcroft Images. David Gowk has been appointed as the new Justice Secretary and Lord Chancellor, the first solicitor, it is believed, ever to have held the post. Seen as a safe pair of hands, the former Work and Pension Secretary is the third Conservative MP within the past year to be put in charge of the Ministry of Justice. Gawke's immediate priorities will be to deal with the crisis in English and Welsh prisons and to reassure demoralised sections of the legal profession when he reviews the impact of cuts to legal aid brought in by the coalition government. Rapid turnovers at the top at the MOJ and heavy cuts to the department's budget, the deepest of any across Whitehall, have left lawyers fearing that its political status is being progressively downgraded. For centuries, the post of Lord Chancellor was held by a succession of barristers and judges. Since 2010, there have been six Justice Secretaries: Ken Clark, who held the position for 2 years and 4 months, Chris Grayling, 2 years and 8 months, Michael Gove, 1 year and 4 months, Liz Truss, 11 months, and David Lidington, 6 months. Only Clark was a lawyer by profession. Gowk studied law at Oxford University and worked for a city law firm, McFarlane's, for 6 years. His wife is also a lawyer. Owen Bocott up, Damien Hines, Education Secretary Damien Hines. Photographed Daniel Lee Lolivas, AFP, Getty Images. Damien Hines is the second education secretary in a row to have gone to state school, but, unlike the comprehensive school-educated Justine Greening, he attended a grammar. First elected to the safe seat of East Hampshire in 2010, he has risen quickly through the ranks to become a Minister of State in the Department for Work and Pensions, where he oversaw universal credit. Before that, he showed an interest in schools as a member of the Education Select Committee and used to chair the All-Party Parliamentary Group for Social Mobility, a cause championed by the Prime Minister. He has had a low profile in the party and media, but, according to his government biography, he previously spent 18 years working in the pubs, brewing and hotel industries, in Britain and abroad. His website lists his areas of interest as business, the economy, tackling disadvantage and widening opportunity,